God hears the cries of all who call out in need. Hear the truth that God proclaims. Your sins are forgiven in the name of Jesus Christ. Led by the Holy Spirit, live in freedom and newness to do God's work in the world. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. Sovereign God, raise your throne in our hearts. Created by you, let us live in your image. Created for you, let us act for your glory. Redeemed by you, let us give you what is yours, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Our gospel reading for this morning is from Matthew chapter 22, verses 15 through 22. Then the Pharisees went and plotted to entrap Jesus in what he said. So they sent their disciples to him, along with the Herodians, saying, "Teacher, we know that you are sincere and teach the way of God in accordance with truth and show deference to no one, for you do not regard people with partiality. Tell us then, what do you think? Is it lawful to pay taxes to the emperor or not?" But Jesus, aware of their malice, said, Why are you putting me to the test, you hypocrites? Show me the coin used for the tax. And they brought him a denarius. Then he said to them, whose head is this, and whose title? They answered, the emperor's. Then he said to them, give therefore to the emperor the things that are the emperor's, and to God the things that are God's. When they heard this, they were amazed, and they left him and went away. Today's gospel story takes place in Jerusalem. It's after Palm Sunday, that would be Holy Week, somewhere around Monday, Tuesday, the last week of Jesus' life. And things are getting pretty tense. Jesus has already told several provocative stories that call into question the authority and standing before God of those Jewish religious elites that he's been knocking heads with. And as retribution, they have been plotting to get rid of Jesus. Jesus today, we hear, is confronted by two groups together of religious leaders who normally want little to do with each other, the Herodians and the Pharisees. Now, the Herodians were Jewish rulers that were appointed by the Roman Empire as a way to keep the Jewish peasants under rule. They outnumbered the Roman army, but it was a way to keep them pressed down. Although we don't know much about them, their fortunes were the result of their loyalty to the Roman authority. And yes, they were Jewish. The Pharisees were also Jewish, who committed themselves to pure worship and the following of God. They despised the Roman Empire and any of the Jews who were in revolt. They didn't like Jesus either, because they thought he didn't follow the Jewish laws as strictly as they did. So the Herodians and the Pharisees team up to trap Jesus on the issue of taxes. After a bit of insincere flattery, they ask him a very volatile question. Is it lawful to pay taxes to the emperor or not? Some more background. Ever since the Jewish homeland was conquered by the Roman Empire, way back in 63 BC, Rome had required a large annual tribute or tax from the Jewish people. And Rome appointed Jewish tax collectors to go out and get it. And that's why many times we hear in the gospel readings that the tax collectors are despised. Because here they are taking money from poor peasants to give to Rome, and they were also considered corrupt as they pocketed some of that tax money for themselves. By Rome imposing a heavy tax burden on the Jewish people, Rome, who occupied their land, kept these ordinary Jewish folks poor and working as indentured servants. The tax was a source of revenue, of course, for the empire, but mostly it was Rome's mechanism for oppression. So, back to the clever question. Is it lawful to pay taxes to Caesar? It's a yes or no question, and either answer would get Jesus into trouble. If Jesus had answered yes, it's legal to pay taxes, the Pharisees would have been enraged. They would maybe say something like, ah, he doesn't follow God purely. He shows loyalty to the Roman emperor. In addition, if Jesus said yes, that would discredit him with the crowds who were following him. Remember, they resented Rome, their rule, their taxation, and they would probably stop following Jesus. After all, if Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of David, as he is saying, he wouldn't side with Rome. But as their king, he would free them from Rome's oppression. But if Jesus answered, no, it's not legal to pay taxes, the Herodians could have pretended to be outraged and say something like, aha, he's guilty of treason. If we don't pay the taxes, the emperor will judge us to be in revolt and will send his army. Spoiler alert, that did happen eventually. Also, the answer of no would indicate that Jesus is performing a crime, treason, punishable by death. So the Herodians and the Pharisees think they got Jesus trapped. But Jesus has a masterful response. He doesn't reply with a yes or a no. Instead, he asks his opponents a question. Reach into your pocket and show me the coin used to pay the tax. The coin they showed Jesus was a denarius, a Roman coin worth a day's wage. Now, Jesus is teaching in the temple, where the emperor's coinage is forbidden. The Jews had their own coins with no idol on it. But now these opponents are caught in their very pocket, in the shadow of God's temple in Jerusalem, where they worshipped only God, was a coin with a graven image of Emperor Tiberius and an inscription of an authority claiming to be the Son of God. Everything about that coin in their hands ran counter to the faith of Israel. Jesus' own counter-trap has been set and sprung. But Jesus isn't done. He commands them, give therefore to the emperor the things that are the emperor's, and to God the things that are God's. Now, in the first half of Jesus' answer, he tells the Pharisees and the Herodians, it's Caesar's coin. Give it back to him. By telling them to do this, Jesus is not giving them an endorsement of paying taxes to Rome. If Jesus wanted to say, pay taxes to Caesar, he could have simply answered yes to their question. The second half of Jesus' response of giving things to God that are God's is provocative because it begs the question. And maybe you're thinking of it too. What belongs to Caesar? And what belongs to God? The Jewish people listening to Jesus would begin to recall scripture, such as Psalm 24, verse 1. The earth is the Lord's and all that is in it. They knew exactly that they had been caught, amazed by Jesus' response. They walk away. Now, Jesus sees the bigger picture. The whole earth and everything in it belongs to God, whose rule far exceeds any human ruler. What belongs to Caesar? Nothing. This lesson is for us, too. Now, you might be thinking, oh, this familiar gospel passage, well, we can turn it into a civic or political lesson about the separation of church and state. But that's not Jesus' point. Jesus was pointing out that when we confess that God created and is owner of the entire world, that it all belongs to him, we're reminded then that law
and government are gifts from God for the ordering of creation. God intends for government to protect society and enable it to flourish. We as Lutherans hold to the biblical idea in Jeremiah 29:7, which says, God calls his people to be active citizens and to ensure that everyone benefits from the good of government. So, that's where churches encourage everyone to vote. It's being a good citizen. So responsible citizenship is a calling from God to each of us. Now, I thought I'd give you two examples to think about. Sue Sunday, who's here with us today, is called to be a volunteer at Mount Zion. You just heard during the announcements how she was replying to a cemetery request. She also volunteers in numerous ways for Monroe Township. Currently, she is the vice chair of the municipal authority. Maybe you've seen a commercial or two for George Scott, who is an ordained ELCA Lutheran pastor, just like myself. He now feels called to serve as an elective representative by running in Pennsylvania's 15th district, which is in Harrisburg. We don't vote for him, but he wants to provide new representation. Both people are Christians, living and acting on their faith, so as to be and do Christ in the world, even in those government callings. But let's be clear. Christ our Lord rules over all aspects of our lives, or as Luther called it, both kingdoms, and there's no separation. In baptism, it is the cross of Christ that has been impressed on our bodies, and Christ is the authority to whom we owe allegiance. No human power can dislodge it, displace him, or challenge his claims on our hearts in this entire world that belongs to him. Amen. We continue with a song, For the Fruit of All Creation. I picked it because all the fruit of creation is God's. We are just servants taking care of it. The music is on page 3 and 4 of your printed bulletin. It's With One Voice 760 if you have a blue hymnal. If you're at home, you can just Google For the Fruit of All Creation, and we'll sing all the verses. Thank you. We continue our service with the prayers of the people. With confidence in God's grace and mercy, let us pray for the church, the world, and all those in need, responding to each petition with, "In mercy, receive our prayers." We pray for the church around the world, that church leaders be supported in their ministries and receive the necessary funding to accomplish their tasks, and that hearing you call us by name, we join with all the baptized to give you praise, even in this time of great trouble. You are great, O God, our Redeemer. In mercy, receive our prayers. We pray for the earth, the lands, the waters, the animals, that what has been destroyed or harmed be renewed, that the wilderness of both storms and viruses be tamed, and that all people become faithful stewards of your good creation. You are great, O God, our Creator. In mercy, receive our prayers. We pray for the nations of the world, that violence between and within nations cease, that ELCA World Hunger and our local New Hope ministries and other relief agencies be enabled to feed those who face starvation, and that elections in the world's democracies be conducted fairly. You are great, O God, our Sovereign. In mercy, receive our prayers. We pray for a right use of taxation, that laws concerning taxes reflect justice for all, that tax monies be directed to worthy uses, and that citizens honestly pay what is fairly charged so that our nation may be maintained. You are great, O God, our Judge. In mercy, receive our prayers. On this day, commemorating St. Luke, we pray for all ministries of healing, that hospitals and clinics receive adequate resources, that medical care be improved in neighborhoods of poverty, in prisons, and in refugee camps, that physicians and nurses be upheld, and that timely hospice care be available to the dying. You are great, O God, our healer. In mercy, receive our prayers. We pray for all in need, for all who suffer from the coronavirus, for all who are living with high anxiety, for those who are unemployed, for those evicted from their housing, for all who experience prejudice based on skin color, ethnicity, or economic status, and for those who need any type of healing, we now name here before you. You are great, O God, our Comforter. In mercy, receive our prayers. We praise you for the centuries of the faithful who have died in the faith, especially for those we remember in our hearts, that at the end you will welcome us all into your presence. We pray. You are great, O God, our hope. In mercy, receive our prayers. Hear us when we call upon you, O God, and enfold in your loving arms all for whom we pray, in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Now, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Now the blessing of Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever. Amen. Our last song this morning is "You Servants of God." If you have the green hymnal, it's number 252. If you have a printed bulletin, it's on page 4. We're going to sing verses 1 and 4 If you're at home, please Google, "You Servants of God." Now go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.